this Saturday morning. We really appreciate it. Today, it's with special excitement that I welcome Dr. John Matthew, a Board of Trustees Professor of Management from the UConn School of Business. This is one of the first times, if not the first time, we've had someone from the School of Business do a presentation for the museum, so that's really special for us. Dr. Matthew's primary areas of research include models of team and multi-team effectiveness, leadership, training effectiveness, and cross-level models of organizational behavior. He has conducted work for several Fortune 500 companies, the armed services, federal and state agencies such as NASA, and numerous public and private organizations. So please join me today in welcoming today's speaker, John Matthew.
Thank you. And thank you for coming out on a Saturday morning. I'm just glad that the women and men are playing later in the day so I don't have to try to draw you away from there. What I'd like to do today is just sort of give you, a feel for some of the behavioral research that happens with NASA and the kinds of work that we've been able to engage with them. I'm going to give you a couple of videos early on here to sort of set the stage so you can see this in a larger arena. And then I'll do a little bit further dive in terms of the kinds of stuff that my colleagues and I have done and are continuing to do here on Earth in terms of studying teams for potential Mars mission. So that's kind of where we're going to go. We're scheduled for about an hour. I can talk for 3 hours. You don't want to hear that. So I'll try to keep it moving along pretty quickly. If you have questions along the way, I'll probably deflect them or answer whichever ones I can. Hopefully it'll give you a feel for what this is all about.
Heard about the great science that can be done with humans on Mars, and we've heard about the technologies we need to make this happen. But there's something critical here, and that's the actual people that we're trying to get to Mars. But why do we need people? Why can't we do this with robots? Just think about the Opportunity rover. It's been on the surface now for over a decade, which is completely amazing, returning science that whole time. But in that time, it's gone a little over 26 miles. So think about what a human brings to the equation. Mobility, flexibility, creativity. I'm a field geologist. I go out and study volcanoes around the world. And I really have this bias that it's going to take a trained field geologist out there on the surface of Mars to really accomplish the science. So our crews every day up on the International Space Station are working on how do we get that human health element? How do we get humans to stay healthy for that 7 to 8 month journey? Mars. And we know from our experience on the space station that we can do this, but we're also well aware of the numerous health effects. Well, it turns out with the current protocols we're using on the ISS with the astronauts, if they exercise about an hour and a half a day, most of them can return to Earth with about the same bone density and muscle strength as they left with. Nutrition. A lot of how we stay healthy has to do with what we put into our bodies. How do we ensure that astronauts on that journey to Mars have fresh food? So just in the past year, we've been running an experiment called Veggies, where we grew lettuce on the space station. The astronauts ate it. They said it tasted fine. So we're doing things to really push what we understand about plant biology, translate that into how plants behave in microgravity, to really understand better how we can grow plants in space. Ocular health. The astronauts have a syndrome where some astronauts come back with some visual impairment. So what is causing ocular problems? We don't know. We're working on it every day on the ISS. Radiation is obviously one of our key issues because once we get out of the Earth's magnetic field, out of the vicinity of the moon, on the way to Mars, the astronauts are being subjected to both cosmic radiation and solar radiation. So we're trying to understand why are some people better repairers of radiation damage at the cellular level, at the genetic level than other people. To a lot of us, I think the ISS, we see those photos from the outside, and we forget what an amazing laboratory it is from the inside. You can see from freezers where we keep samples, from the 3D printer we have, furnace where we do combustion experiments, incubators, microscopes, and then, of course, we have the people who are actually doing the work, the astronauts. So all of this is getting us to this point of getting humans ready to go on that long journey to Mars.
So I chose that video intentionally to sort of lay out that anybody here on campus, any discipline, would have something to tell you in terms of how they can contribute to putting a crew onto Mars. You know, there are just myriad of challenges that are going to face us in trying to do this by the years 2030 is where the current guesstimate is in terms of where we want to go. Certainly, first challenges are going to be on resourcing and commitment. Ultimately, this is going to have to be an international effort. We're going to have our leaders, our political leaders, seriously commit both resources and goals to getting us there, Mars. Without that, it's not going to happen. There'll be some sort of cooperation between not only countries, but private and public. You know, it's not going to be just NASA in terms of when we go. It's going to be some collaboration, okay, between the private sector, the public sector, our partners, and folks, you know, who we don't necessarily play with all that well right now. We're going to have issues in terms of propulsion systems. An engineer doing this talk would be focusing on how we're going to get there. How are we going to lift off? Right now, the current plan is to essentially have a staging area around the moon, where we're sending crews up there for about 30 days at a clip to be working on staging and putting things together so that not everything that's going to go to Mars has to leave the Earth's atmosphere at once. There's going to be issues about entry, descent, landing, sustaining on the surface. Okay, liftoff, getting back. Again, all kinds of engineering sorts of issues. There's biomedical and behavioral issues. You know, we're going to be talking about teamwork here. My first meeting down there, they were talking about intracranial pressure, which essentially says that your brain starts to implode. Okay, and if we don't solve that, then the teamwork stuff, while I think is important, is really going to be cut out. You know, so there are all these things that are moving pieces that are working out, but clearly the crew selection and training and sustainment is going to be part of this. Okay, it's a little bit different than just going to the moon or just going to the ISS where you can see Earth. You know, so we actually were fortunate enough to get a supported contract, a research grant, to study these sorts of things. This here is also a partnership. I partner with a guy named Scott Tannenbaum, who's the president of the Group for Organizational Effectiveness. It's a consulting firm out in New York. We also partner with a guy named Eduardo Salas, who's an eminent professor. He's a university-level professor at Rice. He's a psychologist. My training actually is in industrial organizational psychology, but that's about this far away from me. Okay, but we are coming at it from the social science, side of the way, and that's how we're looking at things. So, again, I want to set the stage here. I'm going to give you a couple of bullets here, then I'm going to give you a little bit longer video where our primary contact, the director of human science for NASA, Laura Landon, is going to lay out exactly what the challenge is of going to Mars. But in a nutshell, there's going to be a four to six member crew. They'll be international. Okay, we will have, they'll be in America. They'll likely be either a Brit or a French. They'll likely be, depending on the sociopolitical system, a Russian. They'll probably be someone from Japan. There may be a second American, maybe not. These will be picked by their home countries. Okay, they will be elite. They will be experts in their field, okay, which makes it very difficult to get them to work well as a team. Actually, getting experts like that is tough. It's going to be, depending on where they launch and where the planetary orbits are, it's going to be 6 to 9 months out. They'll probably spend roughly a half year to a year on planet surface, and it'll be roughly about 9 months coming back. Okay. Once they get out to Mars, it's a 45-minute round trip for communications. Hey, how you doing? That took 22 and a half minutes to reach you. Fine, cool. Okay, 22 and a half minutes coming back. Okay, so when people at the International Space Station, they Skype with their family. Okay, not going to happen in terms of a Mars mission, and they're going to get further and further distant as they go. Okay, they'll have a 24/7 routine. Okay, they'll have extensive periods of work, particularly on the trips out and back, punctuated by life-threatening danger. Okay, they'll be in confined quarters, and they're going to have to be self-reliant. So that's what we're looking at. Honestly, as a behavioral researcher, studying these kinds of folks, I do these talks and people say, well, what can we learn from those? How are we going to generalize that to here on the planet? And my answer is, I don't care. This is cool. I want to study these folks, and if I can study them in an extreme circumstance, then we can start to understand other things. I want to just be able to extract lessons for our teamwork and how do we train people, sustain them, and so forth here on the planet, okay, as well as helping to put them to Mars. So here I'm going to give you it's about a 6 or 7 minute video. It's a little bit lengthy, but she really lays out the foundation of what it would be like to go to Mars.
Hi, so I'm Lauren Landon, and this is the International Space Station. So I'm sure a lot of you guys have heard that Scott Kelly just got back from living there for a year, right? So this is as big as a football field. The quarters on here for living space, it's about equivalent to a 4-bedroom house. So Scott was really living in a luxury accommodation for space. We're starting here. So imagine yourself on a team of about 4 to 6 of your closest work colleagues, and you're stuck in Winnebago for 2.5 years. Okay? You can't talk real time to your friends and family because you're so far away from Earth, there's a communication delay of over 20 minutes. You can't look down on Earth. You can't see nature. You can't see your home. You're having no evacuation options. You have to work out 2 hours a day because your body's deconditioning due to the microgravity. And so there's a lot of discomfort involved. But this is what we're planning for the mission to Mars, right? So, of course, our Winnebago is going to be a little bit nicer, hopefully. But that's the scenario. And so having a cohesive work team on this mission is not just a nice to have. It's something we absolutely have to get right. And so we have great people working on this. And today I want to talk about a couple of maybe surprising things you guys would care about for this mission. So first off, astronauts are somebody when they come to NASA. So they're already amazing, accomplished scientists. They have, you know, lots of degrees. They're military pilots. We had one guy who was playing the NFL and getting his master's in engineering on the side, and then he became an astronaut. So kind of a high-achieving population here. So when we're trying to find these high achievers, we want leaders, obviously, and we need leaders in this space, but we also want a very diverse set of skills and expertise for this mission. And one important aspect of this is they have to be a team of leaders. So because there's this diversity of expertise, the right person needs to step up when their skills are most critical to that task at hand. So the spacesuit gloves are extremely hard to manipulate. People often strain their hands, they rub their fingers wrong. So of course in that space, the medical doctor would easily become the leader. So some of these are very obvious switches. But we're not just talking about leadership here, we're also talking about leadership and followership. So we're selecting great people, right? They're great leaders when they walk in the door, but we also need them to be very team-oriented. So if you're going to be in an enclosed space, you want them to be a very cohesive team. And we bring them to Johnson Space Center, all these highly qualified applicants, about 50 of them, and we put them through some hands-on team exercises. So we actually, you could think of it as a ropes course. And we're observing them, and we're seeing how they're leading when they're working in these teams together, but we're also observing how they're able to step back and follow them. So it's very competitive, right? Everyone wants to be an astronaut. So for some people, stepping back into a follower role is very difficult. But that's what we're looking for. We need that balance. And we also train them when they get to Johnson Space Center. So we have 18,000 applicants this round. We'll pick about 10 to 12. Those 10 to 12 people will then be exposed to different extreme environments. So we have an undersea habitat where they're able to practice these leadership skills. We have a Johnson Space Center habitat called Hera. Right now we're doing research where people are in there for 30 days at a time. We're investigating how teams are doing in this space. And astronauts do crazy, amazing things, like they go on caving expeditions together and practice these team skills. So it's really mimicking these extreme environments that they're going to experience on their missions. And of course, when they get to Mars, we need them to be able to self-correct. So remember, there's that communication delay. They're not able to talk to mission control in real time. So we need them to be able to have leadership and have leadership switches. So it might be a geologist is in charge, kind of your day-to-day on Mars. So go over here, collect this volcanic rock, process the sample. But if an emergency crops up, okay, now we need to make a switch, and we need to make it seamlessly, and we can't have performance loss, because any delay can really be a big, dire consequence. So if a solar panel goes out, maybe the electrical engineer needs to step up at that time. And everybody needs to step back and follow their lead. asking the dumb questions, and that means you have to have a very safe space in which to ask those dumb questions and to throw out different ideas. So creating a psychologically safe team is very important to this process. And what we're trying to do is also train this intact team so that they feel this cohesion, this safe space, long before they launch on this mission. We don't want them trying to figure this out when they're up there. They need to be an intact team before they go. So another wrinkle in this, and this is probably a little bit different than most of your workplaces, is they're also living together. So they're not just working during the day and going home to their families at night, they're roommates. So on Space Station right now, they have, you know, obviously it's a very big space, they have a big four-bedroom house there. They also have these little private crew quarters, and they have a door, they can zip them up, it's about the size of a portalette. And they have personal items in there, they have privacy. Space shuttle missions were about 2 weeks long, and so you can live with anyone for 2 weeks, that's what the astronauts claim. But Mars, of course, very confined space, 2.5 years, so all those day-to-day hassles are really gonna maybe cause a little bit of friction. So if you have a person in your co-working group, and you know that maybe their tic is that they clear their throat a few times a day. Well, you hear it now, every time, for 2.5 years, right? So, of course, we're selecting these amazingly resilient people, right? But they're human, astronauts are even human. And so some of these frictions are going to need to be dealt with. And we're actually training them on how to live together, how to be roommates. So how many people maybe would have appreciated that when they started college, right? Or moving in with your significant other? Yeah, okay. So we sit them down and we talk about, you know, obvious things like conflict management. How are we respecting each other's boundaries? Let's set some expectations on roles and responsibilities. And these can be even kind of non-work things, like how are we dealing with the bathroom cleanup on board, right? Everything, there's nothing off limits, really. And so when they get up to Mars, we also, again, need them to self-correct in this roommate living situation. And so one way we think about doing this is a team debrief. So typically, if you guys are debriefing your team, you talk about the task, an event, you know, what went right, what went wrong. But here, it's interpersonal, it's personal issues as well. So you could be asking each other, are you getting enough sleep? Are you exercising? I've noticed you haven't been talking to the team for the past couple days. You know, what's going on? How are you doing with missing your friends and family? So really, those boundaries are much more expanded. And again, that requires a psychologically safe space in which to have those tough conversations. And so we can kick these debriefs off on regular events. So spacewalk, or we call them EDAs. Those are major events you'll want to debrief after. But somebody could also go to the software program that we're developing, hit a button and say, hey, I got something on my, you know, on my chest and I want to take care of it with our team, but I don't want to feel like a squeaky wheel, so anonymously click the button. Now everyone's prompted to answer a couple questions, and the software program spits back a discussion guide. And so it's going to help that team have this tough conversation. And that way, you set some new boundaries and get back on the same page, right? So when we're talking about all these tools, this training, and I only mentioned a couple of big things today, we have lots going on here. It's really about the psychological readiness. And the psychological readiness isn't just about adaptation and resilience and just kind of surviving in this mission. It's also about mission performance and safety. And that could be making sure your teammate has the right shoes on the right feet before they walk out of their vehicle, right? This is an actual picture from the mission, yeah. So when you're standing on Mars and you're looking at this little blue dot, and this is actually a picture from the surface of Mars, and you see that Earth so far away, you realize that help is very far away too. And so you really have to rely on your fellow teammates, right? And of course, we're not all in this extreme environment, cut off from everybody, but we can, of course, take care of our teammates. We can, of course, create a safe space in which to have tough conversations and to support each other. And that's really a universal concept.
So that's the space that we need to operate in. Okay, that's the team environment that we need to be able to cultivate. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to pivot and give you an idea of the kinds of work that we've been doing. That debriefing that they talked about, I'm going to unfold that and show that to you in terms of how we use that and other kinds of things to understand and predict how these teams are going to operate. And then, most importantly, to be able to come up with interventions, NASA speak as countermeasures. Things to help them avoid potential faults, potential threats to mission effectiveness, and to help them to sustain and be a healthy team. So we're looking at what the NASA NASA calls analogs, where what they're trying to do is simulate features of what it would be like to go to Mars. Obviously, nobody's ever gone there, so that it's not like we know exactly what it's going to be like. So you can think about whether it's submarines or whether it's Arctic expeditions or other sorts of things where people are faced with these extreme kinds of circumstances. Or what you can do is make it more like a more scientific laboratory, okay, where you can control the environment, okay, and people actually are more like guinea pigs, where you can really look very closely at it. We sort of look at the gamut, and I'm going to show you some of these things. One is this place called Hera, which I'm going to show you in a moment. That's a decommissioned train module that's sitting in a hangar in Houston. So this is one of those laboratory experiment sorts of things. I'm also going to tell you a little bit about NEMA. You Google this on your phone. Too easy, you don't get the Disney thing. NEMA is an underwater training facility where our astronauts go before they rotate to the ISS. Okay, so this is a training ground for the real deal in terms of real astronauts. So we've looked at work in both of those sorts of instances. And again, this Hera is this module where astronaut-like people, so these are PhDs, master's degree, engineers, scientists, volunteer to spend a week or two, in these days, 45 days of their life going in and pretending to be astronauts. And they do simulated kinds of activities that astronauts are doing on the way to Mars. And they are then test subjects. Okay, so obviously, you know, there are all sorts of things that are thrown at them to try to understand how a team would work like that. Hera is a 2.5-story kind of structure. The first floor has like this maintenance and operations council where they simulate things like space flight. They have a medical station. Yeah, that's the flight deck. And again, it's all simulated. The idea is to get a psychological fidelity. That is, it's not like the rotation of a real spacecraft. But what are the coordination or cooperation requirements among the teammates that would be important in a real mission, and to what extent can we simulate those sorts of things in what's called a low fidelity kind of environment? Second floor is much more of the living quarters in terms of they have exercise setups, their food, the wardrobe. Up top here are these little bunks, which is most truckers and their bunks are bigger than this. But that's their sleeping quarters in terms of where they go. So this is the setup. That's pretty much them. That's the flight simulation, eating. We have these folks doing various kinds of experiments. This is a building kind of thing. This is some scientific research and obviously a lot of exercise. You know, on a Mars mission, they're going to have to be exercising at least 2 hours a day just to try to maintain the bone density. Okay. In these experiments, there's an entire surrounding force that is running the simulation and simulating what mission control would be like. Okay, so that's what these folks are doing here. This stuff you can't really see. This is basically the daily plot for each person. Each one of these rows is a person. And in terms of what kinds of activities would be scripted for these folks. Okay, there's a lot of things to sustain the aircraft, to do experiments along the way, and frankly, to keep them busy. Okay, because you can think about a 6 to 9 month trip out there. Okay, there's only so many Netflix you can watch. So you got to be doing other kinds of things. So just a little sidebar, they have something called just-in-time training. Okay, so rather than trying to train them on everything that they're going to need to know in the 3-year journey while they're still here on Earth, you know what, let's put some stuff on board. So when they get about 4 months out, let them start to learn the information or whatever their next challenge is going to be. Okay, as they're going, okay, so it stays fresh, they don't get that learning decay, and they've got something to do while they're going. So it's timing out things of that sort. Okay, so a generic research design, this is the experiment, if you will. And again, just to give you a feel for how this stuff is done. Okay, so they're doing these daily activities. I'm going to just do our researchers in 14, 15, they were in there for a week or two at a time. So just as an example, 7 days a week, okay, 24/7, their time is allocated. Before they go, we gather some data about the individuals. Okay, people get trained in terms of what they're supposed to be doing, both in terms of the experiments themselves and in terms of acting like an astronaut. What I can say here is that our taxpayer dollars are being well spent. There's like 12 different experiments going on at once. There are people studying sleep issues. There are people studying stress. There are people pulling blood samples. You know, so there's a lot of different experiments, which on one hand we get a lot of mileage out of, you know, one's crew over time. On the other hand, these things, terms conflate, they bump into each other. So if you're trying to study vigilance and paying attention, and somebody else is trying to keep the crew up all night, all right, they're gonna start to contaminate one another. So those are some of the challenges, which I'll come back to later on. But in terms of this experiment, we're gathering information, we're doing, you know, video interviews and surveys that they fill out over the course of the day. Everything in terms of their activities, other than using the restroom facilities and sleeping, is videotaped, recorded. Again, these folks are really, you know, getting pigs. There's some communication delays that are built in to simulate that lag going towards Mars. The whole thing, in this case, lasted a week or two, and we introduced some of these debriefing manipulations that I'm going to show you in a minute. And, you know, that was our piece in this activity. An awful lot of the research, actually, that's done is gathering data to try to understand patterns of things. If you pee people up, what happens to their vigilance and so forth. Ours actually was a countermeasure. It was trying to give the team something that they could use to help themselves develop and deal with issues. So ours was actually a manipulation, an intervention, if you will. Okay. This is one of the participants. Okay. They weren't wearing all this stuff at once, but this is the kind of stuff that they were wearing. In particular, what we were interested in are two different kinds of things. One is a voice recording, and the second is one of these things. Okay. These things it's called a sociometric badge. Okay, and you wear this around your neck. One thing, those voice recordings, we take their voice and we turn it into text, and we do natural language analysis. So we start to understand that, you know, the words that she's using suggest that she's upset with me. You know, so we're taking their actual words, turning them into phenomena, whether that's cohesion, whether it's conflict, whether they're doing some planning, or she's withdrawn and, you know, she's not playing with the others. Okay, these little things, seconds, they spit off. So they get the voice. They also get the tone. So they go, how are we doing? Versus, how are we doing? Yeah. They get, did I lean in when I said that? Did my voice deepen like I was mad? Did it get light? Okay, was it questioning? Okay, so you get things like posture, you get position. And sometimes these things are very meaningful. We do emergency response simulations with the EMTs and paramedics. Knowing where they are relative to the victims is a really important kind of thing. Where they are here in the harem, we notice that, you know, she's sort of off to herself a lot. Okay, is there an issue here? You know, maybe she just wants some privacy, but maybe, you know, she used to, you know, hang with people, now she wants to go off on her own. Okay, what, you know, is this a leading indicator of something? So the technology that's happened, this is a Google Glasses kind of thing. These are a high-end kind of one of these activity things, telling you steps and, you know, how much sleep you're getting and everything else. So people are developing these different kinds of measures so that people aren't just filling out surveys or doing interviews, and we can get those as leading kinds of indicators of how well the team is doing. Okay, so living together in a Winnebago. That's what Lauren talked about. Okay, so, you know, how well do people align in terms of their compatibility? Okay, and we can think about that on lots of different dimensions. One is, what kind of is their work style? Okay, so I'm the one, well, I like to make decisions quick and fast and do it right. And you're slow and deliberate, and you want to take your time and make sure you get it right. We're going to have trouble getting on the same page. Okay, that's going to create some friction, and we should work through how are we going to collectively make a decision. There are things like interpersonal style. I like to joke and ham it up, and you're better reserved, and, you know, think that's personal intrusion. Again, that's going to be a friction point. We need to think that through. What about sleeping habits? She likes to have her iPad and do the movie at night and have lights in my eyes. Okay, she's a night owl, I'm a morning person. We're going to have problems. Okay, so, you know, how do we work through those kinds of things? Eating habits. Okay, one of our later ones, we got somebody who really, really wants to eat with other people. Okay, she likes communal eating. And the other folks, she's driving us crazy. We just want some space. Okay, so it's those sorts of issues that are 2.5 years in a Winnebago. You know, that's what we're talking about here. And then there's a lot of those privacy group kinds of things. Okay. People who are suitable for these missions have a really strange combination. They have to be very comfortable being alone in their own skin, and they have to be very comfortable being collectively with other people. Most people on this planet are one or the other. These folks need to be both. They need to be comfortable in both kinds of contexts. Okay, that's an unusual human being. Hey, how you? Okay, so we developed a measure that we call living preferences. Okay, you can think about this, I'm happily married, I'm not on them, but on those dating sites. Okay, but rather than asking, do you like, you know, walks on the moonlit beach? Okay, what we're asking about are things like, do you like to have unpredictable sorts of things? Do you like lots of stimulation, lots of action, or are you kind of calm and sedate? Okay, do you like to have order? You want to know where all your stuff is versus kind of chaotic. Okay, preference for privacy, okay, or not. Preference for interacting with other people. Decisiveness, this is getting into some of our work style kinds of things. Or deliberation. So what we're bidding is basically trying to figure out what's your interpersonal style and how compatible is it going to be with other people. And then we're able to index this. So this is one of our first characters. These are four members. One is the commander, two is the flight engineer, and then they have two mission specialists, which are kind of Jack and Jills of all trades. Okay, that's who they are. And we can use these numbers are reflecting how compatible are they across these different work things. So for example, member two and four are very compatible. Okay, they're very consistent. You know, okay, match.com will put them together. Okay, one and three are pretty compatible. Guess what? Most of the activities that were done in this crew, member one and two work together, and member three and four work together. Okay, they're less compatible. They're not negatives, okay, but they're not very consistent with one another. So we predicted right away is that, we're going to see some friction. Well, these folks don't have these compatibilities. And sure enough, what we did is we studied. At the end of every day, they were filling out measures. We did this with some of the voice things, the badges, and all that kind of stuff. But basically, at the end of every day, we're asking, how'd it go? Okay, how'd it go with Monique? How'd it go with Rich? How'd it go with Elizabeth? Okay, and, are you trusting him? Are you cooperating? Are you having any conflict with him? Are you trusting their abilities? Okay, so we're getting these measures each and every day, okay, from a variety of fashions. Okay, and these are fancy statistical analysis, which says, does the compatibility between members predict how well they get along and see each other on an ongoing daily basis? So just to give you a feel for what's going on, this linear thing says over time, people tend to trust one another, cooperate more, trust one another's ability a little bit more over time in the mission, okay, and they tend to have less conflict. This matches how often do they work together. What that's saying is familiarity is breeding comfort. Okay. Get a couple of years out, that familiarity may breed discomfort, particularly if you're not compatible. Well, what our real issue was is, can you look at this interpersonal compatibility and predict these things? And the answer is yes. Okay, beyond a whole bunch of other things that are going on during the mission in terms of how hard they're working, how tired they are, communication delays, and things of that sort. So what this is telling us is that early on, if the Russian and the Brit and the French astronauts are coming together and we know what their compatibilities are, we can anticipate, hey, they're going to have a friction here on this eating issue. Okay, let's get them to start talking about this, okay, before they get in there and sort this stuff out. There's also something weird here that there's something called a debrief that actually created conflict. Well, it still needs its service. That's what I'm going to go with. Okay, so let me give you a quick sidebar here. What do we know about teams? What do we know about research? A couple of takeaways. One, the more diverse a team it is, the harder it is to get them to coordinate, particularly if they've been leaders. You get a lot of alpha dog stuff. People have different languages. They have different time orientations. So if it's a diverse team of experts, our science teams working on things like a genome problem are really hard to get on the same page. Now, okay, people tend to talk about what they have in common, not what they uniquely bring to the table. We put together diverse teams to try to cultivate different perspectives and different kinds of information. But the more diverse the team is, the less they talk about what they know personally that other people don't know. They tend to look for common ground, and that's what they talk about. So you don't get to actually exploit all those differences. People talk about the common stuff. Most people try to avoid conflict. They'll swallow a lot. Okay, let it go. Okay, Warren said for 2 weeks, a space shuttle, they'll deal with it. Okay. Then you tend to swallow a lot of frustration, but then when it comes up in an ugly fashion. Okay, it's not handled very, very, very well. Few people are actually really skilled at team processes. We assume that this is a natural kind of thing, and everybody knows how to work in a team, particularly the current generation. They've been in teams since grade school. Not really. I get a lot of work. Okay, I'm not worried about my job security. Teams have a lot of problems. Okay, so we continue to get a lot of work. So They have trouble figuring this stuff out, and we need to redirect all this energy towards more productive kinds of things. So here's the need for long-duration space exploration missions. It's going to be communication delays, is ice that's isolated, confined in extreme circumstances, and it's going to be greater crew autonomy. How do we help them deal with all these kinds of issues? We need something. We need to send something within this, diagnostic, and really will uncover the sorts of stuff that they're the challenges they have. It has to be effective. Okay, we don't get to test like this. Okay, we need to know when it goes to Mars, it's going to work, right? And it's going to be powerful. It needs to be deployable without mission control because there's going to be this communication line. The crew's got to be able to self-adjust. They're on their own. Okay, we can send them some information, but the team needs to work on its own. It needs to be easy to use. Okay, and it needs to be perceived as useful. Okay, those are all the psychological things. By the way, it also has to be incredibly light because every ounce on a mission to Mars matters, and it needs to not use a lot of electricity. Okay, so there's those kinds of things as well. So what do we do? We use something called team debriefs. Okay, and what team debriefs deal with is they help guide members to reflect on work experience. I'm going to give you a quick video on this in a second. Discuss things in a useful fashion. Okay, get input from everybody. Okay, focus on important team processes and then help them go forward. Okay, effective team debriefs can improve team performance and functioning in an order of 20 to 25%. These things are extremely powerful. Most things in behavioral sciences can't get you that kind of value for your book. Okay, so that's what we're looking at here. So I'm going to show you a video there. So this is our tool, and then I'll talk about how we used it with NASA.
Experience, good or bad, we process it, evaluate it, celebrate it, and argue about it, but we don't always learn from it. Simply sharing what we know or think we know isn't enough. Just as simply working together doesn't always turn a group of people into an effective team. But now we can share experience in a new way, and it will make us better. With the right tool, we can transform our experience into something that informs, inspires, and improves. Debrief Now is that tool. And Debrief Now transforms experience into results. Debrief Now is a web-based tool designed to guide team leaders like project managers, line managers, consultants, or trainers in conducting quick, powerful sessions. Sessions we call debriefs that are designed to help team members reflect on their experience and plan for their future, collectively enhancing their team performance. We've designed Debrief Now so it's simple to use. In just minutes, the team leader logs in from any place with an internet connection and creates a debrief session that fits their team needs. They receive a unique session code and then share that code with their team members. Team members then go to the Debrief Now website and enter their session code. Spending less than 5 minutes anonymously and candidly answering several targeted questions, reflecting their team experience. They're done. Then, Debrief Now uses complex algorithms derived from the study and science of team effectiveness to analyze member responses and produce a customized debrief discussion guide. Team leaders use this guide to conduct a structured team debrief with the team, in person or remotely, that immediately accelerates teamwork by transforming experience into results.
Then it goes in and tells you the pricing. Truth in advertising, I don't make any money off of this. My colleague Scott Tannenbaum at the Group of Organizational Effectiveness does. Okay, this is a tool that they have. It uses it with accounting teams, with healthcare teams. You use it with student teams. Okay, so it's a very powerful tool that gets customized for any particular kind of application. So for the NASA stuff, these were the contents that we look for. These are traditional kinds of task work. What is it that the team's doing? Okay, so a lot of this are being dealing with things like the extra vehicle activities, EVAs, challenges. Okay, you may have heard there's something called after action review. That's basically, it's like special forces goes out, they do a mission, they come back, they clean up, okay, and then they basically do a recap. Kind of like the sports commentators afterwards, they say, here's what went well, here's what went poorly, here's how we should learn from this and go forward. and change what we do or continue doing things at work. So that's sort of a task work kind of piece of this. And that's an after action review is what typically does that. But here we're also looking at how did we work as a team? Okay, did we coordinate? Did people have the same information? When we got under stress, did it get ugly? Did we know what to do when the plan ran astray? And do we have a plan in place in terms of how we were going to improvise and how we were going to come up with something different? So those are team, how we're going to work as a team kinds of issues. And then there are a lot of these rooming issues in terms of how we're orchestrating those kinds of things. So we have questions relatively quick that people answer on that. And it goes through our Cuisinart in the video. It's all those words flying in. We have a Cuisinart that's somewhere between what we know about the research and the science of teamwork and frankly some consultant intuition and savvy. Okay, but what happens is these answers go into the mixer and we're able to come back up and give them a dashboard. Okay, so there may be things that we all agree upon and it's going well. That's going to be down here. Okay, that's not an issue. We don't need to talk about that. Okay, we're good, let's celebrate wins, but we don't need to spend our time on it. Okay, there's some other things where, you know, in terms of how comfortable are you with our decision making? He's saying, you know, we jumped to the decision a little bit too quickly. And I'm saying, you know, it's driving me crazy, we're waiting for it. Okay, we should talk about that. Okay, so that discrepancy is going to raise up the issue on the dashboard here. So what the team gets is a feedback here, basically says, here are your hot button kinds of issues that we recommend you probably talk about. Okay, here are some things that, you know, if you want to, if you get to, you can talk about those. And these things are kind of all on the same page, or it's not an issue. Okay. Important, and this was a huge piece for NASA. We said, we give this to the team, you keep your results, you do whatever you want. We budgeted 45 minutes for you to talk about this stuff. Okay, you deal with it however you see fit. Okay, if you remember a bit ago, I had that slide with all the colors in terms of what was, they were being told what to do, when to eat, how to do it. I mean, okay, this is 45 minutes where the crew gets to decide on their own. Okay, so we give them the information. We give them a guide in terms of, you're going to talk about this. Here's a productive way to talk about this. Rather than saying, you're snoring and driving me crazy. You know, okay? You know, what you say is, you know, people are having some trouble with sleep. What's creating some difficulty? Okay, you know, what's hindered our ability to get sufficient? What's helped our ability? What can we do about these things? Some of these things we can't. Okay, but some of those were tell mission control to stop calling at these hours. Okay, if it's not an emergency, send a text. Okay, it's those sorts of things. You know, some of these things they can control, some of them they can't. You know, what if anything, and then they start pivoting and say, what are we going to do forward? What are we going to do going forward? Okay, so there are instances where, you know, my wife says at times, you know, your tone of voice was upsetting. And I said, signal it. Okay, if I start going, I will try not to do that. But if I start going in that direction, let's have a sign. Okay, this is, you know, tone, I got it. I understand. Okay, simple little cue. Okay, allows us to stay on the same page before it escalates and gets ugly. Okay, those kinds of things the team now can work through. This rises those issues to the surface. Okay, much more statistical stuff. What we're looking at here is crew resilience. If you're doing these things and doing them well, does the team actually become more resilient? And we're indexing that with surveys, observations, those little badges, and other kinds of things. So we can index this in lots of different ways. Okay, so what we're doing is at the end of every day, is getting an index of how resilient the team is. Generally speaking, that linear time says they're getting better over time. The communication delays didn't seem to matter much, neither did the workload. We kept them up late the night before, that did it. Okay. But the money card here is the debriefs. If you did a debrief the day before, it tends to increase. It gives you a benefit in terms of its resilience. Okay. Now, let's predict crew performance. Okay. What's related to crew performance? Again, this is time, the communication delays don't matter too much. If they're working really hard, your performance goes down. If they're tired, it tends to have a negative kind of relationship. The debriefs don't seem to benefit anything here because resilience is going. Resilience is carrying the day. So, you do a good debrief, you get more resilient, that resilience enables you to perform better. Okay, so that's the recipe that we're working on here. And by the way, there's a wrinkle on this. Okay, and that's that resilience tends to become more important. Time. Okay? Okay. The longer you go out there, the more they're stressed. That's when you start to see resilience really kick in. Okay. Sorry, I'm going to do this. When the women are playing most of the teams in the American, okay, you don't know how resilient they are. Okay. It takes a close game before you really know how they can work in crunch time. Okay, that's why Gino schedules all those top 10 teams. Where everybody else is scheduling the, you know, the cupcake teams, he's putting them in a stressful environment. So come March, okay, they've seen good competition. Okay, they've been under fire. Okay, and that's when you can see whether or not the resilience that they've developed actually still matters. You know. So what you see here is that the resilience actually starts to become more and more important over time. This was 2 weeks. They're going to be out there for 2.5 years. Okay, so it's going to flatten off eventually. But the key point is doing anything we can to enhance the team's resilience gives them this reservoir that they can then leverage. Okay, so in terms of these debriefs, I'm going to give you just a couple of flavors. Now, that was people pretending to be astronauts sitting in a capsule in a hangar in Houston. Okay, if need be, you know, it was simulated. And in fact, on the seventh crew, on the 12th day, it was a medical issue, and they literally pulled somebody out. Okay, they were worried he was having a heart attack. Okay, you don't get to do that in Mars. Okay, this is Nemo. Nemo is an underwater training facility where, again, the astronauts going up to the ISS go to Nemo. Okay, it's basically a cross between a little submarine and a spaceship. Okay, it looks just like a spaceship. And they go down there, and the key thing is that they do some experiments and so forth, but the key thing is sort of doing these EVAs. Okay, so they're out in the water, and these suits are buoyancy suits. What that means is that they can simulate the gravitational force that they'll be subject to, whether they're at the ISS, whether at their moon, whether they be at Mars. And what they're doing out there is actually training with tools and techniques for spacewalks, repairing the vehicles, or other kinds of experiments that they'd be doing out there. So this is the acid, this is real astronauts out there. Okay, we got access to a couple of them. NEMO 18 was actually designed to be a research endeavor. Okay, so real astronauts agreed to basically be guinea pigs. Okay, and many of us that had studied people in HERA also got access to them. And we were very fortunate in that, you know, NEMO 19, we were told no researchers. Something you debrief guys in some of the communication books, because you're actually helping the crew. Okay, you're not just gathering data, you're actually doing things that helps the crew get better. So we got to work with them, same sort of deal. As we have that HERA thing that I explained, that's them, it's our little interface right there. Let me just give you some of the, cherry pick some of the comments we got. Okay, so they did the debriefs, you know, they thought it was a good way to, you know, bring information forward. Helps to start a discussion. We can answer it honestly, okay, because individuals may answer on a little iPad these questions, and that goes into the Cuisinart, okay, but you don't know who said what. Okay, so if there's something I'm a little reluctant to bring up, this gives me a vehicle for doing it where it doesn't necessarily get tied back to me and attributed to me. Okay. It facilitates a discussion. Let's have a productive discussion on this thing. It gives you the dashboard in terms of priorities. Okay, and we had latched onto this one. This was before Scott Kelly went to the rover. This was in 2014. Scott Kelly was the guy, the twin, who was up at the space station for a year. Again, they did the guinea pig experiment in terms of physically what happened to him versus his twin brother back here on Earth. So they would say that, you know, Scott could use this sort of stuff. So that's kind of what we did in our first grant. So we've got this debrief thing going on. So what else can we do? How else can we understand these kinds of things? So we've been fortunate we landed a second grant. We're looking at adaptation and resilience, other kinds of things that will help us. Here we got pulled in one of our PhD students, Travis Maynard, who's at Colorado State. Okay, so where else can we study these things? Frankly, NEMO is very difficult to get. Those are real astronauts. They don't want to spend a lot of time doing research. Okay, they're very tough to get. HERA has 12 to 14 experiments running simultaneously. We're still gathering data there, but that's kind of messy. There's a lot of cooks in that kitchen. Okay, so we started to ask, where else can we study these kinds of things where we can learn about them? We've had some conversations with the folks at the sub-base down in Milan. Okay, we're trying to find some common ground, funding issues. Okay, so where else can we look at this? So we've done something called High Seas. Again, if you Google this, okay, it's a habitat that was created in part with grant money, but also the University of Hawaii. It's on the Mauna Loa side of the Big Island. and it's a habitat that crews of six go into for 8 months at a time. We just studied the ones that came out in 2017. Okay, we've got data on them weekly and daily. There's another one that's going to start in about 8 days that we'll be studying as well. International crews, the only time they leave the habitat is to do simulated EVAs. Now, they don't have the buoyancy suits, okay, but they gear up, and they go out, they do geological kinds of experiments and things of that sort, like they do in Mars. Okay, and that's what their habitat looks like. Okay, so here we get them for 8 months at a time. And I can tell you, studying this, you know, studying NEMO or you know, things of that sort, that's like, you know, some real danger. I mean, if they mess up on one of those spacewalks out in the water, that's real danger. And another analog I'm going to give you in a minute, these folks face real-life consequences. Okay, here, you know, nobody's going to die. Okay, but 8 months, okay, in that confined space. It's kind of a cross between being real astronauts and a bad episode of Big Brother. Seriously, I'm not kidding about this. Okay, we have diary kinds of things for these folks. Okay, and it really does start, you get 2 or 3 months out there, the human element, being away from family, interpersonal relations with other folks in the crew, et cetera, et cetera. Your mind can go places here. Okay, that's real. Okay, it's real in terms of what this is going to be like. Okay. Remember those pictures from NEMO, underwater kinds of folks? He said, no, that's the real deal. That's real astronauts, real danger. Everyone else could be fine with this. Okay. The guy's called saturation divers. Okay, they go like 300 meters underwater. Work on the oil companies. Okay, so the oil companies contract with these folks. The saturation divers. Okay, here's what the folks have to say about it. You're walking on parts of the earth that nobody's ever seen before. They're highly trained, they're physically fit, they're intelligent. Okay, we didn't write this. Very astronaut-like. The way this works is there's mission control, which is toxic. Okay, so there's a ship toxic. Okay, and they send them down, and there's living quarters, there's a belt where they go out, they do their EVAs and their work, and there's locks and hygiene kinds of facilities. At 300 meters, remember the band is decompressing? Okay, 300 meters underneath takes about 4 days to decompress. Charlie, you don't suit up, go down and work for 8 hours and come back up. You can't do that. Okay, so what do you do? What you do is you drop the submarine down there and you pressurize the submarine to the same pressure of the water level that they're working at. So these folks live 24/7 under pressure. Okay, whether they're out doing their work in the water for 8 hours or whether they're back in the submarine. There's typically 9 of them down there at the time. And they work in three groups of three. One guy that's in a bell, okay, so he's monitoring all the air and what's going on, sea currents, things of that sort. And there's two divers out there. One's usually the lead, okay, doing the heaviest work, and the second works as a helper. And then they rotate the tools. Okay, so they go out in the water, 300 meters underwater, working on oil lines, okay, whether it's maintenance or whether it's built new construction. Okay, then they come back in here and they drop into this little submarine, okay, where there's 6 other people. Okay, and the sleeping quarters are crammed in like this, and they're down there for about 28 to 30 days. That's basically the cycle for which your body can put up with this kind of pressurizing. Okay, and then they go through a decompressing kinds of things. Teams of people, tight quarters, real life danger. Okay, so when we're looking at, complaints and adaptivity of people in high seas, it's, Charlie cooks with too much garlic. It keeps me up late. Here we get, the hatch was leaking and the space vessel almost flung. This is real deal. You screw up, people die in these things. Okay, they're dealing with currents. There are many instances where the environmental conditions preclude them from going up. Okay, so we get these different kinds of elements in these different sorts of things. So we're studying these folks as well. So just to give you a feel for what, the saturation dying, there's real consequences, there's demanding workload, there's a small volume habitat, all kinds of physical stressors. But it's not like it's the same crew forever. In fact, one of the interesting things that they do is they said there were 9 people down there, 3 crews of 3. Every once in a while, what will happen is crew A will rotate out, B and C will stay, and crew D will come in. Okay? If we're doing a staging operation around the moon for the shot to Mars, it's going to be that sort of setup. Okay? But once they go to Mars, the crew that goes to Mars isn't going to get it. Okay, they're not going to have a rotating kind of crew. So what we do is we try to look for these different analogs so we can study different sorts of things, okay, that will all kind of feed together collectively into some sort of mission logs. So what are we doing with this? This is coming attractions at the end. Okay. We're studying how the crews face different kinds of challenges. What are these challenges? Is it a task challenge? Is it an interpersonal kind of challenge? Where does it come from? How large does it work? We're doing this same sort of work with emergency response teams. We're doing the same sort of work like this with tactical operations centers that Army Aviation has. Okay, in terms of there's a helicopter down there, there's been an attack someplace, or we ran out of supplies. How does the organization or the entity react to these different kinds of challenges? How can we build resilience? How can we build an adaptability ahead of time so that they can confront these kinds of things? That's where we're going with this. And then how can we introduce kinds of countermeasures? Things that we can do before they launch. Things that we can do while they're out there. Things that we can do afterwards. A lot of these things are stressful kinds of events. You know, we're dealing with those Army aviation crews. I mean, they go for some help. Okay, how do you help them recover and deal with some of the post-traumatic kinds of issues? What's the effective way to do that when they come back? How do we, reorient these people to their family? Some of those folks came out of high seas. They hadn't seen their one was they had a fiance. She hadn't seen him in 8 months. You know, that's an awkward reintroduction. Your kids have gotten older. One of those people lost a parent when they were in. Those are tough real life kinds of things. How do we help them reacclimate to these sorts of things? Want to learn more? Take a picture of that. Couple of books are easy reading. This Mission to Mars, our journey continues, is kind of a light thing. It's by Time Warner. Aldrin has some stuff, easy kind of reading. If you want a little bit deeper dive, more of the scientific kinds of stuff, Eric Seahouse has a nice book. It's about 10 years old, but it's still on point. Other things that we do, www.nasa.gov. You'll see a couple of videos that I did. You'll see a whole bunch of other things. Okay, everything from the history of how we've been sending probes to Mars to what the future plans tend to be. Oddly enough, what I'm really going to recommend is coming back around this spring in about a month, is a series on Mars from the National Geographic. I watched that last spring, and it's a real interesting kind of clever way to do it. It's a half docudrama, half documentary. And what they do is they have the docudrama is a movie about a crew going to Mars and trying to set up a sustainability habitat there for colonization. Okay, and it's your typical Hollywood movie type. I won't do a spoiler. But it's cool, and they do talk about a number of the different kinds of stressors that happen. Then they go to commercial, and when they come back from commercial, for the next 2 or 3 minutes, what they actually do is interview current scientists, okay, who are working on propulsion systems, or are working on these teamwork issues, or are working on other kinds of things. So they say, here's what we're doing today, okay, for this mission that may happen 15, 20 years from now. Okay. So anyway, and it's late, you don't have to read any questions. So they did a great job. Okay. Thank you so much.
Because nobody's gone for 2 years, you know. So there's a lot of speculation in terms of those sorts of things. So maintaining that relationship while you're there obviously is the most critical kind of thing. But yeah, coming back in terms of what does that do? Frankly, I have plenty of bar conversations. Do you send men and women? Do you send couples? Do you not send couples? There's great arguments. There's wonderful arguments. You go out there with your spouse. Okay, now what does that do if you've got a couple of couples and you've got a couple of singles? All men, all women, mixed, it's likely to be mixed, it's likely to be multinational,
So yeah, all of those things that, you know, since Rod Serling in the 50s, we've got all these sci-fi movies, and it's in play. You know, people are human. And you saw a lot of, you see a lot of that in the high seas. You know, there are people that just have afterlives. So you really get that sustainability. So yeah, I think both, what are the issues with the crews, as well as what are the issues back at home? Frankly, I look at some of the folks who volunteer, NPR, thank you so much. It's like, on one hand, like, wow, amazing if you volunteer to go for 2 weeks and you don't need anything. And then for a year, okay, it was a year-long mission at Pisces. It's like, what's your personal life? You're willing to leave your husband and your family for a year. You know, what's that about? So, you know, it takes a certain kind of person. So, yeah, nobody studies that.
I'm very interested in like startup or building tech management business, and almost always I have a very serious problem with like a teamwork.
Mm-hmm.
So once I had an idea and form a team,
mm-hmm.
except me, I have three more and they all disappear by the time I submit.
Mm-hmm.
So do you think I can kind of use or study more on this and use this knowledge on like my startup learning or something?
You have no idea how well I'm going to do this. Dr. Rich Dino teaches entrepreneurship here at the University of Connecticut. Okay, deals with startups and coming up with your vision and thinking about how do we translate these ideas to a business. Part of that is business plans, part of that is understanding the marketplace, part of that is figuring out what human capital do you need, who should I surround myself with, how do we, what do we need in order to build this organization? So yeah. Okay, the Mars, we're going to stick six people in the crew and they got to go. So we got to get, but there you're going to incrementally say, who should be my next first partner? Who should be the next person? So what happens is the crew starts to grow and you have to keep asking the questions in terms of what knowledge, what do they bring to the table? Okay, that's going to be valuable for me when my business continues to go to the next stage. Okay, as well as the interpersonal aspect. Unfortunately, it will be locked in winter bay. Okay. But those decisions are just important to the viability of business. So take a course in entrepreneurship. Yes?
Moving to Martian with botanists and growing the potatoes, is there anything from that film that you can say is realistic?
Communication relies. I love the coming back to Earth and slingshotting around it. Okay, it's Hollywood. Okay, but in terms of the notion of your isolation, so that was a little bit more Hollywood. Watch the National Geographic one. Okay, but it was a fun one. Yeah, it was a fun one. Yes, sir.
I was wondering about the self-sustaining aspects. They're probably relatively limited in terms of what they can and can't control.
Mm-hmm.
So how would the ultimate risk of dying on anything that they do or even think about?
I do a lot of work with everything from accounting teams to student teams and things of that sort. And a lot of issues people go, it's tough for men and women or purple zebras to work well together. When you start working with like surgical teams and army teams, the mission tends to trump a lot of that. Nobody cares what color or ethnicity or age the person sitting in the seat next to you is, if your life is on the line. Okay, what you care about, are they competent, can you trust them, are you going to get the mission done? So a lot of times mission trumps a lot of what we would normally see kinds of issues. But in terms of coming up with an adaptability for this or military kinds of applications or others, you have to build in contingency sorts of things. So that I may have those competencies that as Mary brings to the table, and she's our expert, what would happen if we didn't have it? Okay. Who else can cover for that? So there's a lot of cross-training, okay, and you need people who aren't just silos. You need people who can compensate for others. So anytime you start looking for my guy on the accounting team, what are the competencies we need to have? Okay, somebody needs to know the software, the clients. Okay. If we lose that person, we can find somebody else and plug in there. But if we lose them on the way to Mars, then somebody else who's already on the crew has to be able to compensate. So there's a lot of cross-training and a lot of diversity. People can be specialists, they can be an expert in their area, but they also need to at least bring some other kinds of things to the table. Same thing you do when you put together a special forces team or anything else. It's those kinds of issues. So I don't know if I answered your question.
No, I'm just thinking in terms of like risk propensity and stuff with the individuals. I would imagine, I'm not sure if it's true, that each one of them have high risk tolerance.
High risk, they're hard individuals. Now, there's something called psychological capital, which is basically an individual version of resilience. But one of the interesting things is that if you just take a bunch of resilient individuals and you put them into a team, that doesn't necessarily make a resilient team. Just like if you take some of the star athletes, and you put them on an all-star team, a lot of times they have a lot of trouble getting on the same page. Okay, so resilience is a hardiness that you want individuals with that, but they also need to be able to work well with others. Just like Warren was talking about, we want leaders, but we want people who can also be good followers and contributors, and can adapt to that fashion. And those aren't your typical types that we find. Okay, so we have to find, and we need to cultivate and breed certain kinds of attitudes. Okay, and that's why, and I'll get on a new concept. Now, Gino gets the best athletes coming out of high school. Works a culture and get them to work together. Okay, we lose every year a freshman or sophomore who was a superstar in our region. In high school, who's not fitting in or hasn't bought into the system or isn't getting playing time. Okay, so they're very good. They go elsewhere. They start. Okay, and they end up. They may have a career in the WNBA. Okay, but did they fit? Did they fit in this cauldron? Okay, and mix with something and commit to a hard kind of mission. Beyond just their own stat page, again, their own playing cards. That's the same sort of deal that we have to do. These guys, of course. I don't want to stand between you and your pants.
One more?
Yeah.
Will these six people that are chosen, do you think will they take on a certain personality, all the extroverts, introverts, or a mixture? Or it's kind of mind boggling to see that. This experiment will work.
Right. And I don't anticipate that they'll all be the clone and the same. I do think that they will work to be compatible. Candidly, I don't think that they're going to optimize crew composition. When we got our first grant, it was a 3-year grant, and they gave us a lot of money to study this, and we were supposed to come up with an ideal crew composition. In that slide with the planet, what is it, there's six? Maybe one or two Americans, and we're probably not going to have any control over who those one or two Americans are. Why on earth are we studying true composition? We're not going to be able to influence them. You notice our thing was all about the debrief, about crew resilience. We actually got money to study team composition. And we said, we're not going to be able to change team composition. Let's work with some. Okay, so what we did is we said, let's look at how well they fit together. Okay, where are the vulnerabilities maybe? Just like where are the vulnerabilities on the hatches. Okay, and then let's come up with engineering solutions to make sure the hatch survives. We looked at where are the vulnerabilities in terms of crew composition, and what can we introduce to help them deal with their vulnerabilities. So that's where the debrief came from. Okay, we said whatever cards are dealt, there's gonna be some vulnerabilities. Let's figure out if we can surface those, and then help the crew to deal with the faults, that came as a function of what was dealt with. So I would love to say crew composition. I can put an accounting team together. I can help put a special forces team together. We help put together transition teams and got us out of Iraq, as much as we want. So we can do that where we have those options, okay? But this crew, we're not really gonna have an awful lot of options. So it's much more in terms of what service, what the issues are, and help them deal with it.
Team building, diversity is another.
It's one of the things that you can look for.
This almost seems like clones.
I don't want to say clones. They need to be compatible. Okay. So it's not always that birds of a feather.
No.
Okay. They have to be compatible. And in fact, you're looking for something. So if you've got some folks who are just really super calm, every once in a while, you want somebody in there, lighten up. You want that balancing kind of. My daughter does that. Keeps things interesting. probably looking at their watch. So thank you for coming. I appreciate it.